For this construction calamity, we head to Pennsylvania, USA, and a famous bridge that fell from grace.
This is a massive fail. It's utterly incredible that no one got hurt.
If a train was going over it, it doesn't bear thinking about.
What was once considered the eighth wonder of the world is now a relic of engineering oversight. Completed in 1882, at over 300 feet tall and 2,000 feet long, Kinzua Bridge was the tallest railroad bridge in the world.
At the time, this was pretty much the eighth wonder of the world. It was such an unbelievable achievement. Even with today's technology, this would be a challenge, let alone back in the 1800s. So to actually achieve a viaduct over that size gap was incredible.
Building a bridge of this size out of stone or brick would have taken forever, and using cast iron would have been too brittle. So they looked to wrought iron as a suitable material.
Wrought iron had another advantage too. It's malleable. So they used sheets of iron to create an innovative support structure known as Phoenix columns.
These Phoenix columns were made out of wrought iron that was folded around and held together with rivets, and this made them stronger and lighter.
The revolutionary design was also quicker and cheaper to build. However, within a decade, locomotives doubled in weight. This meant more strain on the bridge and more vibrations.
At the time, steel was the strongest, lightest, and most flexible bridge-making material around. So it sounds crazy, but they actually ripped the old Kinzua Bridge down and rebuilt it in steel.
No bridge meant no coal, so a quick construction was essential. And in just a matter of months, 120 men erected the new bridge.
90 days is all it took to completely rebuild the longest railroad bridge in existence.
The new steel bridge used the original trestle design with large A-frames supporting the pier on top. It could now carry as much coal as the steel mills needed. But in an effort to save time, a decision was made that would turn out to be disastrous. Rather than installing new steel anchor bolts to hold the bridge in place, the legs were secured to existing bolts. They were too short, so engineers used extending nuts called collars to bridge the gap.
So replacing these anchor bolts would have taken forever. You would have needed to dig out, blast away. It would have been a real hassle. So instead, they just put these collars over the top of it.
At the time, the collars seemed a reasonable solution, but they hadn't completely factored in Mother Nature.
This quick fix did the trick, and the bridge carried freight and passenger trains for over a century without incident. In 2002, a maintenance team discovered corrosion on the bridge's legs. They closed the bridge to trains and pedestrians and began repair works. But in the summer of 2003, disaster loomed. An epic tornado spiraled towards the Kinzua Gorge. Structural engineer Brian Emberg was on the restoration team.
In July of 2003, I got a phone call, middle of the afternoon, that a tornado had hit the bridge. I jumped in my vehicle right away, made the trip, and got here right about dusk, and it was clearly a tornado scene, trees everywhere, clouds and mist. I met with the crew and made my way down to here to the edge of the ravine, and turned a corner, and the valley just looked filled with smoke like you would expect after a battle. You could barely start to make the structure in the fading light, and you could see pieces of steel emerging from the fog, and then what was remains of the structure still standing. It was clear it was a catastrophic failure.
The 160 kilometer an hour tornado had sent a huge section of the bridge crashing to the valley floor.
So the next morning, I went down to the valley and found these anchor bolts and couplings littering the floor everywhere of the valley, where they had ruptured and failed at almost every single pier.
The choice not to replace the iron anchor bolts with steel was catastrophic. To demonstrate steel's strength and flexibility, mechanical engineers Dr. Mark Zupin and Dr. Tim Topoleski are using a load frame.
The one on the right is 1018 steel, and the one on the left is cast iron. You can kind of see that they look similar. So looks can be deceiving. And what we're going to do is test the two of them and see what happens.
The load frame measures the amount of force required to fracture the metal by pulling it from each end. First up, the iron.
In-tension cast iron expresses a brittle behavior, or a behavior in which it'll fail without warning.
Now, the steel.
There it goes. The steel exhibits what we call ductile behavior. You'll see the specimen narrow in the middle, and that's what we call yield behavior. And essentially, the specimen is absorbing energy to allow it to handle more load. And therefore, in contrast to the cast iron, you're going to get a warning before it fails.
So, although similar, steel's structure gives it increased flexibility, whereas iron can crack without warning. Although steel was clearly the stronger and more flexible material, the bridge's iron anchor bolts didn't fail until the tornado of 2003.
The problem was that the original designer didn't think there was going to be uplift. An uplift comes from wind blowing on the towers. When wind blows on the tower, it wants to try and overturn it, and so on this leg, there would be uplift. The original designer, he used these because he didn't think there would be uplift, when in fact there would be with a 100 mile an hour wind. And it turned out to be inferior, especially after years of wear and tear, and it cracked.
A combination of extreme weather and the decision not to replace the anchor bolts over a century ago was the undoing of this epic piece of engineering.